morning, City Life. How are you? You all well? We are right in the middle of our Super Ordinary Heroes series. Have you looked up? Have you looked up? You should look up. Look at the slingshot up there. Wow, this is going to happen every weekend from here on. A reason to look up. And when you look there, somebody made me aware, but David had 5 rocks, not 3. And that's actually true. So there's a little mistake up there, but that's okay. It gives you a bit of a feel. Last week, we started off the series with Alan Meyer. It was absolutely amazing. So if you haven't listened to it, just listen to the podcast. There is so many super ordinary heroes, and we just heard that they actually also exist in our church. They exist in the Bible, and we'll look at them there. But you know, when you look at people like Joy and many others that are here in the room right now, God actually works through people and works through super ordinary heroes, just like some people that are here right now. The Swedish people have given the world a gift, and that is IKEA. Who here has ever shopped at IKEA? Anybody here? Yes, absolutely. IKEA is an amazing place. They have the most amazing business model. And the business model is that they have mixed two things. On the one hand, when you go there, you buy a piece of furniture. And that piece of furniture is well-priced, well-designed. But at the same time, they also give you a free assembly game as well. So it's like a Lego set, effectively. So you get 2-in-1. And so it's something very, very special. So when you buy something from IKEA, you take it home, and then there's a very, very precious moment that happens. So basically, you get the box home, and then something happens, and it's something that only the male in the family does. It's a tradition that has been passed on from generation to generation to generation. And that is that the box gets opened, the male finds the instruction manual, grabs it, and puts it in the bin. And the reason is that we males do not need any instruction manuals, because intuitively we know how to put together this piece of furniture, because it can't be that hard. So what we do is we then just get going, and you know, everything is going really well until roughly 80 to 90% of the project. And it's at that time that we look slightly nervously around us, because there are some pieces that are no longer fitting and that we have a sense should probably be in there, because we realize that the Swedes who've given us Volvo cars, who are pretty exact, it can't be that they just give us extra parts that are left over. And it is at that time something else happens. Again, it's a male right that has been passed on from generation to generation. And that is the frantic search for the instruction manual begins. Because we want to backtrack and we wonder, you know, what is it that we should have done that we wouldn't arrive at this place? So what am I saying? Well, what I'm saying is that trial and error is painful. It's painful. And learning by doing is totally overrated. A much, much better approach is to learn by observation. I mean, why would you want to repeat everything that maybe other people have gone through it? What else has happened? Why do you want to repeat that again? And that's why the Bible says, Romans 15, it says, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope." So what is written in the Bible here in this book is recorded so that we don't have to repeat the same mistakes again and again. And this is why we're going through this series of super ordinary heroes, because we want to learn from others. So we will hear not just about David today, but we'll also hear about Ruth, we'll hear about Abraham, we will hear about Moses, we'll hear about Elijah, we'll have people like Godwin, my wife Susanna, Andrew, Brasita, Ewan speaking. So it's going to be an absolutely amazing series, but we're learning from people what they have gone through, so that we don't have to repeat the same things. Today, we will hear about David. I love David, and I can prove it, because we called our son David. So clearly, David means beloved. He's a beautiful son. And we'll talk about David. Now, David is someone that has a huge part in the Old Testament and has incredible significance. So when you open up the New Testament, you will actually read the very first words of the New Testament are, the genealogy of Jesus and says, this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, a son of David. This is how central David actually is. Jesus referred himself to himself as the son of David. And you kind of wonder, why does he take such preeminence? And the reason is a scripture that we can find in Acts 13, verse 22, where it says, God removed Saul and replaced him with David, a man about whom God said, I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. There's no one in the Bible where this testimony is actually given by God himself, that he's a man after his heart. And so this is something that we really want to strive for, right? Because God has given us everything. We've got salvation, we've got eternal life, we've got a hope. And so it's actually also the desires of our hearts that we are people that are after God's own heart. And so we'll look at David's life in that light. Now, there's so much written about David. In actual fact, there are 65 chapters in the Bible written about him. So I've got the toughest job of all the speakers. You know, fathers, it's really easy. Next week, my wife Susanna will speak on the book of Ruth. There's only 4 chapters. How easy can that be? Then you've got, you know, Elijah, 12 chapters. Moses, 12 chapters. I've got 65 to cover this morning. And I will lead you through David's life in 30 minutes. I will. You won't believe me? I will. I thought very hard about how to actually bring this life into 30 minutes for you. And so here it comes. This is David's life. In my notes, I have clap at this point in time. I don't know. I thought that I might get a little clap. This is actually David's life. You might not believe me, but I will lead you through it, okay? Let's start off. I put the number 8 here. Why the number 8? Well, David actually was the 8th son of Jesse. And, you know, if David was Chinese, that would be great. I mean, how lucky can you be to be the 8th son? But David was not Chinese. He was actually Jewish. And there, it would be really great if you were the firstborn, or maybe at least the second, or if you were the 7th, you know, the number of completion. But he was the 8th. Not only that, he was just a little shepherd boy in a totally insignificant family. And it was the prophet Samuel that one day comes to this family and says, I want to meet up with you because the future king of Israel comes from this family. And David was so insignificant that they didn't even bother to bring him along. I mean, imagine if Justin Bieber came to the house, everybody would be brought in. But, you know, the prophet came, but they just left him out on the field because they could care less. But it was actually him that God was speaking about. And so the prophet Samuel anoints him to be king. But you know, the anointing didn't mean yet that he was king. It was just God's word that that is what would happen one day. But from there on, it went up quite quickly. Amazingly, he was probably only 17 years old at that time. This incident happened that we can see up here, and that was that he slew Goliath. So the whole army was out there. No one dared fighting. David stood up and said, I'm going to take him on. So he was fighting Goliath. He killed him off. And from there on, everything was just absolutely incredible because he got the king's daughter as his wife. So he was the son-in-law of the king. Then he also had the king's son as his best friend. He became a general of the army. And he basically was the number 2. I mean, that's who he was. He was probably 19, 20 years old, and everything was lining up because there was the word of the prophet that he was going to be king. And it was actually pointing exactly the right direction. I mean, it was just a matter of time that Saul would say, you know what, I'm getting a little bit old. You know, why don't you take on my job? Because all this fighting all the time, you seem to be pretty good at that. And, you know, that's what he thought what might happen. But that's actually not what happened at all. Why? Because there was a little incident, and that was that a song came up. And that song actually is a little bit like what you experience when you're on a roller coaster. Who likes roller coasters? Anybody here that likes roller coasters? Why do you like roller coasters? I don't like roller coasters. To me, the worst part about roller coasters is when you're on your way up, it makes that sound, you know? It's like click, 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 click. And the closer you come to the top, the less the clicking sounds are. It's like click, 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 click. You know what I'm talking about? I'm sure they could make roller coasters that are really quiet. I mean, hey, we live in the 21st century. But the reason why they do that is because they want to scare you. So you know that when these clicks, when the distances of time between the different clicks get shorter and shorter, longer and longer, you know that soon it's going to go down. And that's exactly what happened with David. This song was a little bit like these clicks. It was like going up the roller coaster just because you're going to go down very soon. And the song was, Saul slew 1,000 and David slew 10,000. It became a really popular song in Israel. Now, how do you think did Saul feel about that? Saul wasn't excited that this was his son-in-law that got all this glory. Why? Because the prophet Samuel had come to him early on and said, you were not obedient to what I said, so therefore I found someone else, actually someone after my own heart. And suddenly Saul realized, just a moment, this young guy that I brought into my household, he's actually going to be the one that will kick me off my perch. And so for that very reason, he actually started chasing David. And as quickly as David went up, he was maybe 19, 20, as fast he went down. In actual fact, he was on the run. Initially, he was all by himself. Then there were a few people that joined him. Why? Because he went into the desert, and the desert was the place where people lived that were outcasts, that had run away from the law. And these were the only people that he could pick up. I mean, what can you do? And he also found his first wife at that time. So he was on the run, and the Bible tells us that he was on the run for about 10 years. This wasn't a quick thing. So I'm drawing a little cave here. Why a cave? Because he had to hide. He had to hide in lots of places. And Saul tried to kill him off on a regular basis, and he was kind of escaping. And you would think that over time it would get better, but in actual fact, it got worse. It got so bad that a time came where not only was he in the desert, not only was he a chaste man, but there were other people that were causing him trouble as well. And his wives and his children and everything that he had was actually taken away from him. While he was out on a raid, someone else came in and took all of this away from him. And so his own people actually at that point wanted to kill him off. So you can't think a lower point. That was the absolute lowest point that he could get to. But amazingly, within literally hours, the picture changed. He was able, by divine providence, to recapture his wives and children and all that he had. But he wasn't aware of that. In parallel, exactly at that same time, there was a battle going on. And during that battle, Saul and Jonathan were killed. And from there, literally overnight, it went all the way up again. So he became the king of Judah. He was 30 years old. And 7 years later, they made him king of all of Israel. So finally, the prophecy had actually come true. He was the king of Israel. And during that time, it was an amazing time of influence, because he was able to extend the borders of Israel, and he was able to subdue other nations, so they had to bring in the tribute. So a lot of wealth actually flowed into Israel, and it was just the absolutely most amazing time. He had 20 years of winning every single battle, of accumulating lots and lots and lots of wives and a lot of wealth. But then something happened. And I write the little number 50 down here. When he turned 50, something pretty bad happened. So 50 is a very dangerous age. I'm 52. So at 50, something happened. The Bible says it was the time when kings went to war. And there was a pretty important war actually going on. That's when David decided he was going to stay home. And he was in his palace, and he stepped out on the balcony of his palace. And it says that he saw a woman bathing herself. And the Bible says this woman was of unusual beauty. So she must have been absolutely stunning. You kind of wonder, why do you take a bath in full view of the palace? I don't quite understand that, but that's what happened. And so David is looking out and sees this absolutely beautiful woman bathing herself. And so as he looks, he turns to his servant and he says, Who's that absolutely gorgeous looking woman? And it's quite interesting what the servant answers. The servant answers, this is Bathsheba, the wife of Uriah. I find it a very interesting answer because I think the servant already got a feel where this might all be heading. So he sent a message to David and he said, this is her name, but she's married. I mean, you know, hands off. But David doesn't listen. He actually brings her into the palace. He sleeps with her and then he sends her home. He thinks this is it, you know, just kind of a one-night stand. He should have known better because the law in the Old Testament was very clear. It was actually the death penalty risk on someone who would be committing adultery. So he knew exactly that this was totally contrary to what God wanted. So he thought it all ends there, but it actually didn't. Why? Because Bathsheba sent him a little message a few weeks later, and that was, David, I'm pregnant. So now David has a real problem because, I mean, imagine this coming out would have been literally his end. So he thinks of plan A. He says, you know, nothing that can't be fixed. So he makes sure that Uriah, who is Bathsheba's husband, comes back from war because Uriah was a powerful warrior in his own right. And so he was involved in that war where David was actually supposed to be. So he brings Uriah back and says, why didn't you have a little holiday? You know, just relax from war, you know, all this blood all the time. You know, just spend some time at home with your wife. You know, it's all going to be amazing. But then Uriah acts in a totally unexpected way. And that is rather than being at home and with his wife, it's actually something that the king instructed him to do. He camps in front of the house. He doesn't enter the house. So David is totally confused and says, "What, Uriah, what are you doing? I told you to come home. You can just enjoy yourself." But Uriah says, "No, I can't do that. How can I be with my wife when the people of God are fighting this incredibly important battle and where the presence of God, the Ark of the Covenant is there? I can't do that. It's impossible for me." So he puts David to total shame. So now the plan A didn't work. So now David thinks of plan B. And plan B is quite harsh in comparison. And then he thinks, well, okay, I'll do something else. I'll have Uriah killed. Because then Bathsheba is a widow. I can get married to the widow. I will bring her into the palace. She will give birth to the child. Nobody will really find out when that all happened. And so from there on, again, I'm covering my tracks. And so he sends a note to his general and says, put Uriah right in front of the wall in this fierce battle. And not just him, there were a number of other soldiers that were actually put into that same place to have them killed. So it was not just Uriah that died that day, but a number of others actually all were killed off. So exactly that, what David planned to happen, happens. And Uriah gets killed. And so he takes Bathsheba in. All looks hunky-dory because no one will ever find out. Well, the problem is God knew all along. And so God sends a prophet to David and makes him aware of what he did. But before I come to that, let's reflect on what actually happened. I mean, it is a horrible story when you consider where David actually came from. But it is even worse than this. Let me tell you why. Because when David was here in the desert during this time, it was a very significant time for him because he actually built the group of people that would carry the future government with him. So he found his future general, there was the future high priest that joined him, and there were 30 mighty men that were with him. And they did amazing things. I mean, they fought amazing battles. And you won't believe it, one of those 30 that was with David in the desert when he needed it most was actually Uriah. So the person that he had murdered was not just anybody, it was actually someone that had stood alongside him all along. And not only that, Bathsheba's father was a man called Eliam. And Eliam was another one of the 30 mighty men. So you can actually imagine what happened that, you know, when those 30 were together, you had Eliam and Uriah. And I mean, they fought the most amazing battles. And then one day, Eliam probably said, "Hey, Uriah, I've got this beautiful young daughter. Why don't you get married to her? Why don't you take her?" She was actually 20 years old at that time. So Uriah was probably a little bit older than her. Bathsheba's grandfather also was a very significant figure, and that was a person called Ahitophel. Great name, just in case you want to name a child, Ahitophel. Ahitophel was one of the wisest men in Israel. He was actually an advisor to David. So when David did what he did, he killed off Uriah, who was one of his 30 mighty men, and also that generation as well of people that had served him, Eliam, and Ahitophel was his advisor. He put them to shame all at the same time. So that was the kind of betrayal that David was involved in. So it makes you wonder, how can that happen? How can someone like David, who had experienced the miracles of God through so many different ways in all these battles, and God had intervened supernaturally, why did he do what he did? There are probably two pointers in the Bible why that happened. The first one is, I mentioned it early on, that David actually took on many wives. I mean, he had many wives and concubines. There are lists and lists of children's names that he had. You know, sometimes we read through the Bible and we just think, oh, okay, that's just a list of names. Well, it actually was not, because in the law, it was clearly prescribed that the king should not have many wives. It actually said that there. And David knew that very, very well. So throughout his life, this was not the very first time, this was not just a moment in time, but he had actually overstepped a particular mark a number of times before. Yes, he did not commit adultery before, but he had fallen in a particular area that God had told him not to cross. And there's another reason, I believe, why this happened, and that is this little sentence given in the Old Testament that David, when kings went to war, decided to stay at home. David thought that he was going to be in the safest place possible, which was his palace. But in actual fact, he didn't know that that was the unsafest place. He would have been safer out in the battle lines. You know, when I read this, I think how important it is that for our own lives, that we are not sitting back. It's so easy to sit back, especially, you know, after maybe this age moving forward. So easy just to think, you know what, let the young ones do this. You know, just let other people fight it out. You know, I've had all these battles. And I'm not talking about a well-deserved rest, but what I'm talking about is a hard attitude to basically stay on the cutting edge. When I think of people like Kevin Connor that served this church over so many years, I could see him be on the cutting edge until the very end. There was never a moment where I felt he had lost his passion and his dedication. And so in the same way for us, I believe it's so important that we don't sit back. There's never a time to sit back. This is not what life on earth is for. Life on earth is for being in the battleground. It's the time for kings to go into war. It's not the time to sit back and to relax, because you will not believe what's going to happen then. What I find is that in those days when it's really tough, we actually pray a lot. When we've got some challenges, we pray much. Is that true? Anybody agreeing with me here? And then when God hears our prayers, you know, suddenly our prayer life goes down. I'm actually grateful that I speak here on a regular basis, because it makes me study and pray. It's a good thing. It's good for me. I'm being served right now. You won't believe it. And so in the same way, I think for us as well, we just need to be aware that there's actually a danger of being in this place. So the prophet Nathan comes to David, and he tells David a story. And he says, there was a man, and he had a little female lamb. That's all that he had. And that little lamb was really, really special to him. I mean, he absolutely loved that little lamb. He spent a lot of time with him, and you won't believe it, he even took the little lamb into his house. And then the prophet Nathan says, but there was also a man, and that man was very rich. And he had a visitor, and that visitor came to his house. And he thought, wow, I better give him a really, really, really nice dish. And so he thinks of all the flock that he has, all the animals that he has. But he thinks, no, I'm not going to waste one of my animals. So he goes to that man that only has that one little lamb, grabs it off him, slaughters it, and gives it to his visitor. When David hears that story, he's shocked. You know what he says? He says, this man should be killed. And then Nathan says, you know what? This is actually you. This is exactly what you did. God gave you everything. God gave you riches and wealth. He took you. You were an absolute nobody. God took you. I took you from the pasture, and I put you into a position of authority, and you could have had whatever you wanted, but you took it away from someone who actually had only that one little female lamb. And it was clear what the allusion was, that this was Bathsheba. So David's reaction to that is positive. Why is it positive? Because being a prophet to kings can be a very dangerous job. Quite a few prophets actually lost their lives over telling the truth. But for David, he actually took it on board. He repented. But there were consequences out of his actions, a number of consequences. The first one was that child that was born to Bathsheba died. And not only that, but the following 20 years after this incident, David was on the run from there on. And this time he was on the run to be killed, not by Saul, but you know who was chasing him down? His own sons were chasing him down. And remember when I said he had all these wives that he had accumulated, all these women, his whole harem, you know what happened to that? One of his sons actually pitched a huge tent, an open tent, and slept with all his wives in public to make sure that he instituted himself as king and to remove David. He didn't succeed, but that's what he did. So there were 20 pretty tough years that came from there on. You kind of wonder, you know, wow, that's pretty harsh that David had to go through all this. I mean, after all, he repented. But I think we have to understand a biblical principle. And that biblical principle is that there is grace and grace on forgiveness, but it doesn't mean that there's no consequences for sin. And I know it's not something that's very much, you know, not very palatable, but that's the reality. Let me illustrate that. If I walk out of here after this service and I kill someone out there in the street, and I pray and I genuinely repent, I know I shouldn't have done that, and I go to a judge and say, you know, God has actually forgiven me, that's not going to work. You know, like one thing is true, God has forgiven me. But at the same time, there are consequences for sin. Now, God in his grace sometimes, you know, moves and shifts things, and we don't have to bear all the consequences of our sin. If we did, all our lives would be very, very miserable because we're all sinners. But on the other hand, there is a warning in the scriptures as well that life will not necessarily just go on. It's good that that's there. Why? Because it puts the fear of God in us, which is very important. Just think about it. If there had been no consequences for David at this time, what the people of God would have been like, what Israel would have been like. Everybody knew what happened. Everybody, what do you think, even without glossy magazines, it would have been a well-known fact, everything that David did. And he did not die. And nothing actually happened. What do you think, what would that have done to the people of God? So ultimately, there had to be consequences. But the good thing is that even throughout all of this, God was faithful to David. Yes, he was being chased, but I draw a line up again. Why? Because, as I said, he repented, he moved on from his sin, and he actually stayed close to the Lord. But then, with 70 years, he passed away. Now, are you all depressed at this point in time? A little bit. That's okay. Because let me tell you David's life again. And this time, from a different perspective. And that is, let me tell you about his heartline, his heart rate. Why? Because remember we were reading at the beginning, what makes David so special? Because he was a man after God's own heart. You know, this is David's lifeline. It looks like that. And you know what? This is what lifelines look like. They look like this. They are an up and a down. But the much more important question is, what's the heart rate? What's the heart line? So let me tell you David's story again. Yes, he was an unknown little shepherd boy, but the reality is that the Bible tells us that when he was a little shepherd boy, he killed the lion and the bear with his bare hands. That's pretty amazing. That's like outstanding. You don't normally go and fight a lion and a bear this way. You know, if I was a lion and a bear, I would be a little bit confused if a teenager suddenly started running towards me and trying to kill me off. I once read about lions that they are able just with the swing of their paw to decapitate a human being. I mean, that's how strong they are. So it was not coincidence at all that David was chosen as king. It didn't just happen. It wasn't just the random lottery that it was, oh, well, let's just pick this one. Why? Because all along this very short life of David, he had actually been someone that was passionate for God. He was a man of faith from the very beginning. You know, sometimes we talk about children and teenagers that they are the church of tomorrow, but that's not true. The stuff that David experienced and that he did when he was a teenager. I mean, some of the biggest conquests actually happened at that point in time. And that's the kind of faith that we need to have for our children, for the children, the young people here in this church, that they will have an impact now, not in the future. The impact was there and then. So he was someone that was absolutely passionate for God. So God knew, God said, I found David. I found him when he was still right there. Why? Because of the heartbeat that he had. Then when you think of the time when he was at the top, I mean, he was probably 19, 20 years old. I mean, what an incredible position to be in. But you know what? He was an absolutely humble man. When Saul gave him his daughter for marriage, you know what David's reaction was? He said, I don't deserve it. Who am I? I'm just a little shepherd boy. That's amazing, because the deal was King Saul had told the army that whoever would beat Goliath would actually get the daughter in marriage and would no longer pay any taxes. Who would like to pay no more taxes? That would be great. I mean, imagine that prospect. Which of the two was better? But anyway, so the fact was that he was going to get the king's daughter, but he said, you know, that's not me. I mean, who am I? So he was an absolutely humble man. Then when you think of the time when he went into the cave, his heartbeat was absolutely for God. Amazingly, David wrote about, 73 psalms. 73 out of 150 are from David. I mean, what a worshiper. But the interesting thing is that out of the 73 psalms he wrote, only 13 were actually written at the time when he was king. 60 of them were written before that. So even though he was in this incredibly challenging time here in the cave, he was absolutely passionate for God. And not only that, when he had the chance twice to kill off Saul, it was like almost, you know, looked like divinely orchestrated. He was in a cave, Saul was there, he was vulnerable, he didn't have any bodyguards, no weapons with him. David said, I'm not going to touch him. Why? Because this is the Lord's anointed, and my time will come, but it will be in his time and not in my time. So you can see he was such a passionate man. He was an absolute man after the heart of God. Then when you think of the time here when he was king, he was not primarily focused on extending the borders of Israel and bringing all of this wealth in. Yes, that happened. But when you read the pages of the Old Testament, actually something else was constantly going through his mind. What was that? What do I do with the presence of God? What do I do with the Ark of the Covenant? How do I actually bring this in its own rightful place? There are chapters and chapters just about that, about the question of how do I position the presence of God? I mean, it was the Ark of the Covenant was in a little stable. Then he tried to bring it to Jerusalem. Then it wasn't quite working out that well. Then he did it again. Then at least it was in the rightful place. Then he pitched something what is called the Tent of David. Fascinating. Kevin Conn has actually written a book just on the Tent of David. Why is it so interesting? Because it's theologically puzzling. Let me tell you why. Before the tent of David, there was the tent back then in Moses' times, and then you had the temple later on. And before and after the tent of David, it wasn't possible to step into the presence of God. Whenever you did, remember there was an outer court, inner court, the Holy of Holies. But in the tent of David, that was actually not the case. It was actually open worship in the presence of God. How did David know that you can do that? You're allowed to do that. He was actually tapping into the new covenant. And you can, whoever wants to study that a little bit more, read Acts 15, where it talks about in the apostolic council. They're referring back to the tent of David. Why? Because it was a foreshadowing of what was actually going to happen under the new covenant. So it was incredible. And again, I mean, that must be someone who's in tune with the heartbeat of God, because you couldn't actually make that up. So he had that tent of David. He had 24-hour worship, but he said, I really, really, really want to have a home for this presence of God. I want to build a temple. So he goes to the prophet, talks to Nathan about it, and says, hey, Nathan, I really want to build a temple. And Nathan says, great idea, really good idea. So he goes home, and overnight, God talks to Nathan and says, no way, this man will not build the temple. So Nathan comes back the next day and says, David, just slight readjustment. You will not build the temple because you're a man of war. Your son will build it. He's going to be a man of peace, but you will not build the temple. And then something fascinating happens at this point. And that is, you would think, I mean, God has told him not to build the temple, so that's the end of story. You know what happens? David says, fine, I can't build the temple, but God didn't tell me that I can't get all the parts and the components for the temple. So remember what I was talking about earlier about IKEA? David builds an IKEA assembly set for his son. He actually brings all the parts and the components in. Why? Because he says, you know what? I'm not going to build this temple, but the moment that I drop dead, someone else is supposed to start building the temple. God didn't tell him that. It just shows what a passionate man for God he was, how passionate he was after the presence of God, that he wanted to make sure that this is actually going to happen, that there's going to be no excuse. Whoever comes after me is just going to pick up the pieces, just going to go ahead with it. And then when we think of this time, which was the absolute lowest point of David's life, there is a bit of a missing heartbeat. There's probably a year where we don't really know where David's mind was at. But when he was actually confronted with his sin, which was a horrible sin, fact is, he repented with all his heart. You know, it's so easy when we do fall into sin just to gloss over, to blame somebody else, to, you know, say a glib prayer. You wouldn't find that with David. There are times when you actually do need to genuinely repent for things. Read Psalm 51 or read Psalm 32 at that time, and you will see how deep this went for David. I mean, he did repent from all his heart. He fasted and prayed. He wanted to reconnect with this God that he knew so closely. And you know what? It's kind of interesting, because under the Old Testament law, David should not have survived, right? I mean, he committed adultery. He committed multiple murder. But somehow, he was still alive. Again, he tapped into the grace of God. And like I said, even though there were consequences of his sin, God kind of buffered them a little bit, and it didn't come in its full brunt. Why? Because David's repentance was so clear, so obvious. He was desperate to keep walking with God. And so that's why he actually did walk with God closely until the end of his life. So it's not like with some of the other characters in the Bible that we can see did not run the race to the very end. David actually did. And the king that was installed after him, and that's another sign of God's grace, actually was Solomon. You know who Solomon's mother was? It was Bathsheba. So while the first son died, God in his grace actually said, out of all the sons, I mean, there could have been any other son, God said, you know what? This is the one that I want, the son of Bathsheba. So God's grace was intermingled in all of this. Now let me just wipe this off a little bit. This is the really important line. This is the line that counts. For us, our lives do go up and down, and we fall into sin, and there's things that happen in our lives that shouldn't be happening. But what really counts is the heartline of our lives. And so this is the heartline of David. He was a man after God's own heart. And this is why Jesus was not ashamed to call himself the son of David. Would you feel comfortable with that after everything that I just outlined earlier on? It was not a problem for Jesus. Why? Because he knows of our failings. But the more important question is, where was he throughout this whole process? Now, let me turn this around. I feel a little bit like a magician this time. Let's move on to somebody else. Not David, but you. What is your lifeline? I have no idea. You know, if you're older, then maybe this is where you are. If you're younger, you might be here, or you might just be here. I don't know. Life is ups and downs. And there's absolutely nothing wrong when you're on the up. That's great. God actually wants to bless us. That's in his heart. He's a good father. He wants us to see success, prosperity, health. We know that from the Bible. And you might be at that point that a promotion has just come through, you're newly married, you find the love of your life, you discover the call of God on your life, you had a health scare, but you know everything is fine now, and that's good. And this is the time when we are on the up. And you know, there will be multiples in our lives, and even though life is tough, when we really recognize it, there's a lot of highs in our lives, there's a lot of blessings, a lot of good things that are happening. But maybe you are on the low. Maybe it's not all those things that I described. Maybe the opposite. Maybe that role that you were going for, that career, has come to a sudden end. Maybe that person that you thought you would spend your whole life with, you will not spend your whole life with. Maybe there's relationship issues. Maybe it's some tragedy in the family. Maybe your health is not where you would hope it to be. But you know what? That is actually not the real question. The real question for you and I actually is, what is our heartline throughout all of this? Where is our heart? Why? Because it is so easy when we are at the top to forget about him or to push him to the side and suddenly everything else becomes so important. But also when we are down in the lows, it's so easy as well to blame God and to tell him to move to the side, that we're not really any longer interested in his goodness because clearly he hasn't displayed it. It can be times when we just get into desperation. But when we look at David's life, he was so different. Both when he was at the top and when he was at the bottom, he always made sure that he was close to the Father. There's one psalm where David says, I've got the Lord always before my eyes. Always before my eyes. And this should be the goal for our lives. Why don't we just stand on our feet for a moment? And I don't know where you're at. You know, sometimes we are here at the low point because of other people, and there's nothing that we could actually do about that. We didn't cause this. When you look at David's life, Saul caused all kinds of problems, but it was not his doing. And it can happen to us as well. With all our best efforts, we don't understand, you know, why is this happening? Why? How come this all occurs? But it can also be our own failure as well. You know, maybe you did take a serious misstep in your life. That's quite possible. This is why you are the situation that you're in. Maybe God actually blocks your path. That can happen. Happened to David. You know, there were 10 years where he was in the desert. And the reason why it was 10 years is because it was just not the time. It was just not ripe. It wasn't yet that whatever was going to happen had to happen. And you're trying very hard, but actually God is blocking your way. That can happen. Or it can be the devil. For David as well, it says that he tried to have a senses and Satan stirred him up to do that. Satan can also interfere in our lives. So I don't know what it might be for you. But I just believe that wherever you are at, whether you are at the highs or at the lows, I believe that we should realign ourselves with God's purposes and God's heart.